the Master of the Wind program with Wayne Boyles. Join us now for a time of singing and a timely message from God's Word. Now, here is Wayne Boyles.
Go with me today to the book of 2 Peter. Book of 2 Peter. I'm going to be reading verse 4 for our text verse. The title of the message today is Promises of Priceless Gifts. Promises of Priceless Gifts. A gift is something that's given to us. I tell you what, and we have a lot of them in the Holy Word of God. Some of them I'm going to talk to you about in the message today. Promises of Priceless Gift. Through God, there's power. And through that power, we have many things. And I believe with all my heart that we need to reach for the promises of God today. And God has so many of them that's not being claimed by His children. So we're going to look at some of God's priceless gifts, the promises that we have in them. Verse 4, 2 Peter, the first chapter, Peter recorded, "Whereby are given unto us exceeding and great and promise and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust." We're going to be looking at just a few things from the Word of God here today in this message. I pray that I'll get it in this service. If not, we'll continue the next service. But the Bible teaches us many things about God's gifts and the gifts that God offers to mankind and the things that we can have. And these are going to be heavenly gifts. I'm going to just say it that way. And the first one we're going to find that of these gifts, the first one we have is a heavenly protector. And then we have heavenly provisions. We have heavenly person. We have heavenly preservation and a heavenly place. And maybe we can get through these today. But let's first look at the heavenly protectors. It's a good thing to know that while we live, there's someone watching over us. First of all, they minister us as heirs. I think you know what I'm talking about when I say they minister to us as heirs. I am a joint heir with Jesus Christ, my Lord and my Savior. And while I walk on this earth, there's a promise been offered to me, a gift that's been given to me, and that is a heavenly protector. And that protector watches over me every move that I make. In Hebrews 1:14, listen, you don't have to turn and try to follow me this morning unless I ask you to, because I'm going to be moving pretty fast. But in the first chapter of the book of Hebrews, the Bible says in verse 10, "And thou, Lord, in the beginning hath laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thy hands. They shall perish, but thou remainest, and they shall all wax old as doth a garment. And a vesture shall thou fold them up, and they shall be changed. But thou art the same, and thy years shall not fail. But to which of the angels said he at any time, Sit on my right hand until I have made my enemies thy footstool." But listen to verse 14. "And they..." Listen, "not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister, not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be the heirs of their salvation." I enjoy the feeling of believing that angels are around to minister to us in the day that we're living in. Heavenly protectors, they protect us for more than you can ever imagine. And not only that, they guard us as sons. We have them to minister us as heirs, but they guard us as sons. In the 91st Psalm, verse 11, he said, "For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy way." Now, I like this because the Bible says he'll keep me in all of my ways. This is a prophecy of the Son of God. When he was standing on the pinnacle of the temple, Satan used this verse of scripture and said to the Lord, "Why don't you just cast yourself off the pinnacle of the temple and fall this 90 feet? And the Bible has said to you that God will pick you up and you'll not dash your foot against a stone." And of course, God looked at him and said, "Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God." And so the Bible teaches us though that we have ministering spirits. They watch over us, they guard us, and so they take care of us. In verse 9 of the Psalm said, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. Isn't that good? In other words, we need to realize that someone is watching over us. The Spirit of God's in us, but someone watches over us. We have angels as ministering spirits. We have angels that guards over us as sons to protect us, to watch over and take care of us. Many times we live in the time we're living in, we think about, you know, our houses that we live in. We think about the properties we own. We think about going down highways. We ought to realize that someone is with us to guard over us, watch over us, minister to us, and take care of us. So we pray from our house before we go to sleep at night. Surely you pray many times, watch over us, and many times we fail to think about that angel that can watch over us, take care of us, can put out the fire, that can take and can protect us from thieves, protect us from many things. And we ought to feel that comfort, and I know probably that you do. If not, remember this message and remember that angels are to guard over us, to take care of us, watch over us, and have the faith that they'll do it. I believe with all my heart from the Holy Word of God that we can feel secure as we serve the Lord throughout our lifetime on the earth. And then not only that, these heavenly protectors, they minister to us as heirs, they guard us as sons, but they'll carry us home at death. The Bible teaches a great truth about what takes place when we leave this walk of life. I promise you, there is always around us a guardian angel, someone that's taking care of us. But there's also a death angel that has a duty to perform at your death. And I'll tell you, that death angel is assigned to your death, and it will not slip upon him. The Lord of this universe knows exactly when you're going to die, and he'll have that angel to leave the portal glories of heaven and will come alongside that guardian angel that will be in the room right beside of you. At that moment, the soul exits the body, and those angels will carry you through this universe into the presence of the paradise of God. I said the paradise of God, not the streets of gold, the paradise of God. And that's exactly where the throne room is today. And the Bible teaches us we'll go there, and that place will be where we'll rest till one day we'll be brought from the portal glories of heaven, go to the body, wherever it may deposit, resurrected, stand up if you please, and go yonder to meet the Lord in there, and to be judged, and then come back with the Lord for 1,000 years to rule and reign upon the earth, and then go into eternity with the Lord when time will be no more. And that's where the bride of Jesus Christ will be housed in New Jerusalem, and all the rest of the people will be on the new earth. Matter of fact, I believe Israel will be encamped around New Jerusalem when it sits on the new earth. But the good thing about this is to really believe that we shall not have to worry. David said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. We should not fear death. No one wants to go through the process, but we should not fear death. We should believe with all our heart that we'll not have to make this journey alone from this earth. I'll tell you, listen to me, we don't understand the spiritual world. Many people don't even study the spiritual world from the Bible. Many people are afraid of the spiritual world. Many people say, there are no demons today, and these evil spirits are not around. And it just goes on and on and on. But I promise you, there is a spiritual world, and we'll step into it one day in death. But the Bible teaches us in the 16th chapter of the book of Luke, the story of the rich man who died, and in hell he lifted up his eyes and he was in torment. But the Bible said, but the beggar also died, and he was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. I promise you, that's good. You see, that's a gift that God's given us. That's a gift that God has given to every child of God. You can't beat that. Heavenly protectors. And then we have heavenly provisions. How many of you feel like it God's going to take care of you? Do you really believe that God is going to take care of you? Well, how many of you are taking care of yourself? I mean, if something were to happen, you'd fall all to pieces if you started losing what you got. If you'd fall all to pieces in losing what you got, or if you fear losing what you got, or you fear what's coming down the next day, then you're not depending on the Holy God. And I promise you, you'll run out of fuel in trying to live in this life if you have a fear of what's going to take place tomorrow. The Bible teaches us that tomorrow is sufficient to take care of itself, and that we're to take care of today and today only. And God's made a promise to us that He would take care of us, that He would provide to us. So, listen, He said, I'll give you all you need. How many of you believe that? How many of you have more than what you need? I mean, how many of us have more than one automobile? Now, you know what Satan said to us concerning an automobile. My wife's got to have one, and I got to have one because my wife works. And if we're depending on God, our preacher get in trouble with that kind of stuff. Genesis 3rd chapter, 2nd chapter, and 1st chapter are still real in God's Word. But we got to have that other car because one's going this way, nothing's going this way, right? And we got to have the best insurance we get because we don't, you know. And then a lot of people don't drive without insurance, you know. I understand all that. But then we turn right around and put that 16-year-old to something that's got to be done. And if we don't have this, we're not successful. Now, do we really need all this? Is what we got what's pulling us away from what God Almighty really wants us to have? You know, God said when He sent Jesus Christ to die for the sins of the world, the first person that Jesus said, I died for, is the poor. And you know why He said that? Because the poor is the one that will accept Him and do right. Just live. And the most happiest people are people who, depending on Jesus every day, and really believe that Jesus is going to provide that day that they live. And the Bible teaches us it's a great truth that He'll take care of all our needs. The heavenly provision, a gift from God. God said, I will take care of your needs. I may not supply your want-tos, and I may not supply to take care of the things that you wanted and you got on your own that you've killed yourself for, and I may even take it from you to take you to be with me because you've never really depended and trusted on me for your needs. And so the Bible teaches us it's a heavenly provision. It's a gift. It's a marvelous gift. God said, I'll protect you and I'll take care of you. The Bible teaches us in Philippians 4:19 said, but my God shall supply all of your needs according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now turn, if you want to, the book of Matthew. Let me show you a great truth, how much God loves us. In the 6th chapter of the book of Matthew, we find a great truth of how God said, I'll take care of you. Beginning with verse 24, God gives us a promise here that's so easy. Listen, everyone understands this verse of Scripture. Everyone won't practice this verse of Scripture, but everyone understands this verse of Scripture in verse 24 of the 6th chapter of the book of Matthew, where He said, no man can serve two masters. Now, that's pretty simple, isn't it? No man can serve two masters. No man. Now, I wonder why that is. One master says, do this. Another master says, do that. You don't have time to serve two masters. You can't do what this master says and please this master and turn right around and hear from the other master, this is what I want you to do, and serve this master. You can't do that. That puts you in a bad position, doesn't it? We call it fence straddling. How many times have you ever heard a preacher preach this? Buddy, you can't stay long on the straddle of a barbed wire fence. Now, a short-legged man like me really understands that. I mean, some of you fellows can walk up to a 3-strand barbed wire. You might can walk up to a 4-strand barbed wire, and a lot of people putting 5 and 6. And you might be able to push your hand down on that thing and step over it and go on. But I'd have a problem. And as close as you put those 5 and 6-strand barbed wires together, I'd have a problem going through it. So a fence like that would be a problem for me. And if I tried to crawl over that thing, I could be in bad trouble, couldn't I? Now, the Bible gives us a simple truth here. Our Lord Jesus Christ is telling me, Wayne, you can't sit on the fence. You'll either serve me and be blessed, or you'll try to serve me and the other master, and you'll not have time, and you'll fail at what I require of you to do. That's why most people don't have time to do anything in the church today. They're serving two masters. They got to take care of what they build up or got, or they're building to have, or they're searching for a job, or they're afraid they're going to lose their job, or they're griping and complaining about the living that God's given them. And they're just uptight everywhere we go. And they don't like to hear preachers say, God said that he'll provide for our need. I always pray that God will take care of y'all, because the better God will take care of y'all, the more you'll take care of me. And you know, God's always provided for us. We've been ups and we've been down. You've been fearful for your job. Don't you know your pastor, when you lose your job and somebody else lose their job, and it'll get down to the place to where I'll have to take a cut and pay too, or I'll lose my job. I can tell you right now, over three churches that I've heard about recently that has gone from full-time ministry, cut back, and their pastor had to go to work. I mean, I understand all that, and I know what can take place, but I do know this. If you'll depend on the Lord, and I'll depend on the Lord, it won't bother me if we get to that place to where I can say, whoa, wait a minute. I would feel terrible. But I'll tell you one thing. There's one thing that we both have a promise of, and that is to serve one master, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. And to trust him, because he said that he would provide our needs, not our want-tos. I'll tell you what, it always disturbs me, folks. I really believe, and I talked to a man not just a while ago, that I looked at him and I said, I tell you what, we'd love to help you out. And I wanted to help him personally. He said, no, sir. No, sirree. I said, we'll take your love off. No, sirree. Now, there's nothing wrong with taking love offers in different times, and our church is as good at this. But this individual, not a member of our church, he told me, he said, brother, I'm going to tell you something. As long as I've got something I can sell, if I ever get to the place where I don't have anything to sell, he said, I'll tell you what, preacher. He said, I don't feel right, not with two cars on the highway. And he started naming these. He said, when I don't have all these things, and then you see that, he said, come to me. But he said, matter of fact, when you see that, he said, hey, I'll come to you. Now, folks, let me tell you something. We've got a lot more than we need. The Bible teaches us that God said he would provide for our needs. I just read that a moment ago. And here he says you can't serve two masters. There'll be people quit church and take a job to try to pay for what they got. Terrible. I've been in trouble down through the years with people who said, I've got me an offer of a job, but to take this job, it'll take me out of the church. What do you think, preacher? I said, don't take the job. That's what I think. Boy, you want to get somebody stirred up. Let them be financially broke. They got a job offer, but it's going to take them out of church and come to a preacher. And if that preacher's got any, listen, spiritual depth at all, he would never advise anyone to take anything that would take them out of church. Do you think that's the master of the book that would put a man 7 days a week out of church for a living? That's not what the book teaches. The Lord tells us to allow the master to supply our needs. And he said he would, according to his riches in glory. He's rich. He said he'd provide. And he said, I'll do it by Christ Jesus. So if you're saved, you're the richest person on the globe. Amen. Aren't you proud to be saved? I mean, don't you feel rich to know Jesus as a personal Savior? Never can money take you anywhere that Jesus can't carry you. He'll carry you above an alcohol bottle. He'll carry you above a pill bottle. He'll carry you above these things if you trust him. I promise you that. I promise you that. The Bible teaches us that the reason things are the way they are is people trying to serve more than the master of the wind, the master of the seas. Oh, I could go on and on and on. He said, you can't do that. He said, for either you will hate the one and love the other, or else, listen, he will hold on to the one you cannot and despise the other. He said, you cannot serve two masters. That's just as plain, cut, and dried as it can be. Couldn't make it any plainer than that. The Lord said, please serve me. He's reaching out his hands today to the world, trying to get people, men, women, boys and girls, moms and dads and grandparents to come to him, great grandparents, to come to him and receive him as a personal Savior. And then he's trying to say to this world, I can take care of you. I can take care of you, and I'll do it a day at a time. The Bible said, listen to this in verse 25, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat and the body more than raiment? Think about that for a moment. Is what we got, does it mean more to us than our health? Are you killing yourself trying to do what you're doing? Are you got so many? Are you running yourself down a highway of no return? You see what the Bible's teaching us here? Is that stuff worth more to us than our body? You know what the Lord wants out of you and wants out of me? He wants us to live as healthy as we can live, where we can live long, a long life, to where we can serve Him, that others can actually see Jesus in our house, in our yard, in our community, in the church, and can see us year after year and see the stability of that person who got saved, came into the church through scripture baptism, throwed herself out here and said, I want to work for the Lord and do the work of the Lord, and started doing that and did it for year after year after year. Folks, it wouldn't be an Oakwood Baptist church if it wasn't for people like that has come along. Yet some have come along and stayed stable for a number of years and then fallen aside and fallen away. But is their testimony anything? Does it mean anything to you? Some of you sitting here can mind right now clicking and thinking of someone who's just come through us, got us all excited, and then we wonder, whew, where are they at? They went out like a puff of wind. They came in all fired up, came in looking good, smelling good, feeling good, excited, get here on time. Listen, come in here and, hey, I'm a part of making this place feel happy. Huh? But all at once, you wonder and you think, and then you know, and away they go. Amen. Amen. You know what? When we really believe that today is all that's promised us, someone today, God forbid that it be from this assembly, will not make it home from church service. Someone will not make it home from the fishing hole. Someone will not make it home from a job. Someone's going to die today. Will it be you? Will it be me? Only today God has said, you're living. And while you're living, give me the honor and the glory for it. Drop the other master and turn to me, and you'll never receive from the other master what you'll receive to me. It does not have to come in material things. Let me tell you something, friend. The greatest feeling you'll ever have in your whole life is to follow up on that promise you made the Lord when He washed your wretched soul white with the blood of Jesus Christ. When you actually received Him as a Savior, and how good you felt, and you was ready to fight the devil, you was ready by the power of the Spirit that came into you to empty the bowels of hell, if you could speak, for the power that you felt when you got your sins washed away, and how great it is to continue through the years serving that master. And when you turn from him and you look back and you think about how good it used to be, remember, you're the one left that used to be. But if you will turn back to this master and latch on to him, hold on to him, I promise you that feeling will be renewed in your spirit, and you'll become that person that you were back yonder when your sins was washed away. Y'all remember that? How happy were you? You feel good? How did it feel when you went before a congregation and you saw their hands go up that you're going to receive scripture baptism? How good did it feel when you walked into that watery grave? And how did it make you feel when you were pushed under the water to represent the death and burial of the resurrection of Jesus Christ? And how did it feel when he brought you up out of that water and you faced this congregation and you said, hey, Boy, I'm ready. And that testimony that you represented there was to the world, you was ready to say, look at me, look at me. I look and walk and talk like Jesus. And brother, 10 years later, someone say he's still walking and still talking. 10 years later, they say, I believe he's getting better every day. And 20 years down the road, still good. And the family by that time is tailing along, Dad, Granddad. They're beginning to say, that's real out there, because he'd been doing it for 30 years. And then 40 will pop around and 50 will pop around. And then in death, they'll walk by and they'll be able to say these words. And I love to hear them when I'm representing the gospel of Jesus Christ at someone's death and that funeral. When a child says to me, or a grandchild says to me, or a great-grandchild says to me, well, I'll tell you one thing. My loved one sure did love Jesus. You can't beat that. You can't buy that. Not in this world. And I'll tell you, that's the only thing that'll be rewarded in the next world. You can have it all here, and people look at you and say, whoa, boy, I wished I was that person. But if it's not serving one master, you're a pauper. You're a loser. You don't understand what's going to take place today. You may die. And in doing so, you'll go yonder in the presence of the Lord. And then one day, that resurrection, you'll stand before him and be judged. And you'll hear nothing from him according to the works that you could have done. And oh, what it must be like to think about standing yonder at the judgment seat of Christ, where all our works are open to all believers, and see others who worked around you, worked by you, even pastored you, receiving rewards, and you know that you know that you know it could be you. You got that opportunity today as I speak. Today while we live. That's why the Bible says work while it's day, because there's going to come a night that you'll visit your dark house, the grave, and you'll have done nothing for Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And what a shame it's going to be. So the Bible goes on to tell us, behold the fowls of the air in verse 26, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? God said, don't you know you're better than these things that I've got flying around out here, the fowls of the air and all this? And he said, don't you know that you're much better than they are? He said, don't you know that I take care of them? And then he said, which of you by taking thought can add one cubit to his stature?
This has been the Master of the Wind program with Wayne Boyles. We trust that you have received a blessing from today's program. And if it has been a blessing to you, please write and let us know about it. Write Master of the Wind, Post Office Box 532, Russellville, Alabama 35653. And we invite you to join us again for another Master of the Wind program.